What's interesting is that in the earlier period here, it was mainly small banks that were lending to individuals. But as this goes forward in time, the bigger banking institutions get in on the action. As of 2006, just to give an example, Citigroup and Bank of America had over 3/4 of their portfolios dedicated to lending to individuals. This is not a little side business that they're running. This is integral to their operations. More than half of the profits of Citigroup in that year came from their consumer services segment. HSBC was around the same neighborhood at around 43%. Citibank made $200 million in profits that year simply from student loans, just to give people a sense. I mean, $200 million used to be a lot of money. I know now it's, but it used to be a lot of money, all the way back 6 months ago. This lending is very profitable. Why? Because the individual approaches lending because they need to satisfy basic needs. And the bank is approaching it as a calculated profit maximizing operation. This means when you look at balance sheet operation that it's significantly more profitable than most other activities. You're a bank, what do you want to do then? You want to increase this line of business, which means that you want to engage in more lending, but you also want to increase your market share, which led a lot of banks in the United States to buy credit card companies, for example, in the 1990s. They basically wiped the independent out. And we saw earlier this decade, they're moving into the mortgage business, buying a lot of mortgage origination outlets. And of course, there will be a push for technological innovation and financial innovation that will allow you to do more of this. And of course, and I'm not going to have time to go through this, this came to a head after the dot-com bubble because profitability elsewhere lagged, so the financial system as a whole became even more focused on this kind of activity, and willy-nilly, everybody was convinced very soon that you could make profits drawing on the income of people who have no income, which is effectively what happened, and you had all sorts of fancy instruments to convince you that you could, and clearly this can only happen as long as there's a bubble, and you had a bubble, then it ended, and then this whole thing came crashing down. Second point, because I'm running out of time, the iniquitous Keynesianism. The big idea is that in a setting where there is a broad fall in investment in the private sector and a policy commitment to low fiscal deficits, the way to boost aggregate demand is to personal debt and consumption. Basically, free the living hell out of ordinary people to sustain aggregate demand that is falling not least because of collapsing investment from the private sector. This was made explicit by Clinton and Greenspan as the earliest reference to it that I have seen. The idea is you keep your deficits low, so you placate the bond market. Bond market will lower interest rates. Lower interest rates means more house buying. More house buying means more collateral for people to borrow against, so they can consume and boost aggregate demand. That's the logic that was put forward. And we see, again, from the 1980s onwards, what I have here is U.S. household consumption from the post-war period, a break with a historical pattern starting in the early 1980s. Early to mid-1980s. Of course, as we know, around this period, the red line here is the income of the bottom 90% in the United States. So consumption is rising, but the incomes of the majority are falling. The first reflection of this, of course, is the collapse of the savings rate and the increase in consumption in relation to disposable income, which goes well above 95%. And of course, that means borrowing. And we're back to the figure that I started with. Now, when the dot-com bubble crashed, policymakers were, this became even more important for policymakers because remember in the investment graph that I showed, there was a second bump of investment. Yes? 1995 to 2000, that collapsed. Alan Greenspan, as recently as last year, in what must be the most regretted book ever published, his autobiography, says consumer spending carried the economy through the post 9/11 malaise. And what carried consumer spending was housing. This was a big boom for morale. You basically here have the policy imperative. Now, it became even crazier as you went forward. 2004, this is a report from the Fed to Congress. And this is what I call the perpetual motion machine that they thought they had discovered. The Fed is assuring Congress that, see, household debt has increased by 10%. But that's not a problem. Why? Because the assets, and it has increased because of mortgage borrowing. But that doesn't matter. Because the assets of households have increased as well. And why have they increased? Well, because home prices have gone up. So we're okay. Of course, the house prices were going up because people were borrowing more in the mortgage in the first place, increasing demand for housing. Right? Some people knew this is what was going on. Other people didn't. A lot of dumb things were said around that period. Shows like location, 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 and whatnot didn't help. But the point is, and it came out yesterday in the discussion, that once they got deep into this regime, the states would actively support anything that kept the bubble going. And by 2004, the only way to do it was subprime. Now, one last thing, and then I'll conclude. Another element of this push for housing, which is being pushed not only to boost aggregate demand through this iniquitous Keynesianism, and it's being pushed also because it is obviously highly profitable to the banks, is ideological. The Democrats were pushing for Freddie Mac to be more aggressive in 2006 because poorer people were finding it hard to get in on the housing ladder. Well, no shit. The idea of that perhaps public provision might be the solution, and that a bubble tells you that private provision is not the way to satisfy the housing needs of the majority, of course, doesn't occur to these people because that's not their policy. Greenspan, again from the same book, writes that government encouragement of subprime mortgage, first regret, enabled many members to become homeowners, minority members, Latinos and blacks in particular. And this expansion of ownership gave more people a stake in the future of our country, which voted well for the cohesion of our nation. The stakeholder society, which here in Britain we know about very well from the privatization of countless states under Thatcher. The IFC, who has been pushing versions of this internationally, says this in a document about Mexico. That it's good for stability basically because it locks people, especially poor people, into a single asset, which is good for social stability. Punchline is, that makes you free, it turns out. It also makes some people very rich. Regulation, all I want to say about regulation very quickly is that it shouldn't surprise us that regulation was less because the subprime bubble was part of a regime that was calculated and understood. They weren't going to disrupt it. To conclude, and very, very quickly, even more quickly than I usually do, and to restate the point, the crisis that we're experiencing right now can be understood as a crisis and an exhaustion of the turn by the financial sector to wage income as a source of profits, and can also be understood as an exhaustion of this highly iniquitous form of Keynesianism that we have seen since the late 1980s, early 1990s in a number of countries in the world. Now, as I said before, and just to forestall some of the discussion, or perhaps to encourage some of the discussion, obviously these two processes follow from underlying changes in accumulation in the real economy. Those relationships, however, are complicated and require further study. But from what I've laid out, we can identify a couple of things that in an operational fashion are vital for Marxism. In the following sense, we can understand that the crisis has developed as a result of increasing inequality, has developed as a result of privatization of social services, it has developed as the result of changes in the investment and capital market behavior of non-financial corporations as they sought to maximize profit. To Marxists, this should be a bonanza. Why? Because we're in a position where very clearly egalitarianism, the social provision of things, and economic planning are not just nice ideas, but can be argued convincingly, I would say, to be the very things we need to get society as a whole out of the hole that it finds itself in. And if you take a step back and think about the political instrumentalities that can bring these changes about, of course we're in a very strong position to argue that there is a class in society who, by struggling in its own interest, actually, in an inherent sense, gravitates towards achieving those demands, the working class, which is in a position to lead the way out of the crisis in the regime that gave rise to it. That's me.